Good evening, everyone. My name is John Frasinelli. I am a division director here at the State Department of Education. Thank you so much for joining us this morning on behalf of both Commissioner Russell Tucker, our Commissioner of Education, and our State Board of Education. Thank you for joining us this evening with this conversation. We are blessed tonight to have with us a distinguished team of partners from the Connecticut Children's Medical Center. You will hear from each of them shortly. And we will have some conversation tonight about making sure that students are able to attend school and be safe and be healthy throughout the winter season so that we will have a joyous holiday season and be able to get back to school in the early winter. So we have a lot of information to share with you tonight. And so without any additional delay, I wanna thank Ingrid Kennedy, our Executive Director of CERC, who's going to lead us through tonight. And I also want to thank our panelists for joining us and thank our team at the State Department of Education, Judy Carson, for helping us put this on tonight. So with that, Ingrid, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you so much, John, for that introduction. Good evening. As John mentioned, my name is Ingrid Kennedy, and I want to welcome you all to this afternoon's webinar title, Staying Safe in School During COVID-19. An evening with Connecticut medical experts for parents and families. So since our time is very limited this evening and we have a wealth of information that we want to share with all of you, we're going to go ahead and start right away. Our expert panelists are going to be sharing with us a few key general topics full of lots of information. We all have experienced the last 2 years with a lot of challenges, concerns, that we want to ensure that as part of this series of sessions, we are bringing you the most updated information with our partners at the State Department of Education and the Connecticut Medical Center as well, to make sure that you receive the information right away, and it is the most recent information for you. So it is definitely my distinct pleasure to have our three experts today who are going to really provide us information about the implications of the COVID and any variants that we have become aware of. How can we continue to build community between school and families to ensure the best health for and outcome for our students? What are the mental health implications of everything that we have gone through the last almost 2 years? So today we have with us, as we mentioned, three experts, medical experts. We have Dr. Juan Salazar, we have Dr. Robert Dudley, and we have Dr. Robert Ketter. And they are all going to provide you with rich content. And we do hope that as they are providing the information, please, for those of you who are joining us today, take note that it's going to be information here, not only for you as a family member, but also information that you can share with your children, with the students. I know that we have some professionals that also have signed up, teachers, they have signed out into the line as well. Professionals at all levels, educators, families, and community members at this session today. We are very excited to be providing you with this wealth of information. So through their insight and expertise, they are going to address our most frequently asked questions about vaccinations, quarantining, mask wearing, social distancing, social emotional supports, and all other COVID-related health concerns. So without further wait, let's start. So I would like to actually start and welcome Dr. Juan Salazar, who is going to be sharing with us the latest information about the virus and what can we anticipate regarding future developments. Dr. Salazar, feel free to start with us and feel free to share your screen as well.
Okay, thank you. Hopefully everyone can see that.
Yes, thank you.
Let me just put it in presentation mode. Okay, very good. Ingrid, thank you for your kind introduction, and it's really an honor to be here. I'm also extremely thankful with Commissioner Russell Tucker for putting these series together for the community. This is supposed to be a conversation, so please What we cannot answer directly from you today, please let us know. We're happy to respond to that. And we're also happy to respond to you here at Connecticut Children's. This is your hospital, this is your community, and we're here to support the children. So let me begin with my first slide here. What I'd like to do is review very briefly the epidemiology of COVID-19 in the world. We'll go to the US and then we'll transition to Connecticut specifically. I'm also then going to tell you a little bit about where we are in Connecticut, where we are with Omicron, and what my recommendations will be for you with you as parents and the children, the teachers, the things that we can do. And then my colleagues will obviously give you plenty of practical information about how to work with within the school system with the kids, and then some of the emotional needs that they need to be addressed. In this graphic here, and I've been using this throughout the pandemic for the presentations that I've made, and what it shows here is a map of the world. And this is from Johns Hopkins University. Here in red, and I'm highlighting here in red, the total number of cases throughout the world. It's really incredible. 272 million cases of COVID-19 have been diagnosed throughout the globe. What's really more impressive is the number of people who have died of COVID-19. It's almost 5.4 million people. It's almost twice the population of the state of Connecticut that in the past 22 months have died as a result of this new virus. But the number in green gives us hope. There is a very large number of people that have been vaccinated already throughout the world. Almost 9 billion people have gotten the vaccine. Now, unfortunately, the U.S., and you see here on the left, leads the world. And this is not something we're proud of, that we're leading the world in a pandemic for many, many reasons. But here are the numbers, and I'll show you the U.S. in just one second. You go to the right here in this graphic, in the red histogram, that shows you the number of cases. And you can see here the bumps. We had back in April, of course, was the Northeast, and the South in July of 2020. We had a very difficult time in the summer and winter of last season, in the spring. And now we're in the midst of this latest surge, which I'll tell you a little bit about and try to explain it to you and why that's important. Now in white, you see the number of people that have died as a result of COVID-19 throughout the world. And you can see here in a 28-day period, 28 days, that's 1 month, 205,000 people died of COVID-19 throughout the world. All right, let me go to the next slide. And here, this is the US, same kind of information, but specifically now focusing in the United States of America. And you can see that total cases have now eclipsed 50 million cases, almost 50.5 million. And we, this week, unfortunately, we surpassed 800,000 individuals that have died in the US of COVID-19. And in some publications, people believe that this is probably about 1 million. So maybe we could be undercounting some of the people that have died, some of our fellow citizens, some people that you may know, parents, grandparents, and people who have been sick with other diseases that get COVID and have passed away. And that to us is very painful, very tragic in so many ways. And then the last 28 days, 33,000 people have died of COVID-19. Now, the good news is that 485 million Americans, we have given 485 million doses of the vaccine. These are actual doses. That's why it's more than the actual population of the US. And in the last 28 days, 39 million doses have been administered. That's good news because we're going in the right direction from that perspective. And then you can see the histogram on the right in the red. You can see in the beginning, that's the months of April of 2020, April, May, the first part of the pandemic. Then we had a little hump there in the summer of 2020, which was 500,000 people. Many died during that period. It was mostly in the South. And then we had that winter last year, which everyone I think will remember for a long, long time, where we had our hospitals were full here in Connecticut. Many people died, almost in the US, almost 20,000 people are dying as a result of COVID-19. Then we had a little surge in the spring. The vaccines came in here and then they started to drop dramatically. That was good news for all of us. We had a good summer, relatively good summer, but then early on in late summer, Delta came in, this variant that we're going to talk about in just a little bit, and it caused a lot of havoc with a lot of disease and a lot of deaths in the South primarily. And now we're in our latest surge, which is the one you're seeing here on the right. And this is related to the Northeast and it's winter, and I'll show you where that is right now. And again, in white, the number of people that have died as a result of COVID-19, and in green, those are the number of weekly doses of vaccine. So it looks like there's a pickup. People are beginning to pay more attention with the number of vaccines that are being given. Now, this is another graphic that I like to use in this, and let me walk you through it so that you understand it. It's a little bit complex, but it's very useful for you to know where the disease is active right now. So here's a map of the U.S. You can see Alaska, you can see Hawaii here and the little tiny dots here. And what this is telling me, and this is from MIT, this is the COVID-19 predictive analytics. What does it tell you? It's a color-coded, and these are the number of active cases today per million. So it's per million people. So it's normalized across the United States of America. So it takes into account the population. And dark means more cases, light means fewer cases. So the example is Connecticut is currently in the purple. It's gotten purple. It was 3 months ago, it was quite light yellow, a few cases in the summer. But with the onset of the winter, is that the entire Northeast has become darker because we're seeing a real resurgence of COVID-19. So Connecticut is purple, corresponds to 10,500 cases per million in Connecticut on any given day today. That's a lot of COVID. And I know that because I've been getting calls from a lot of parents, getting calls from a lot of patients, and they've been testing positive for COVID. Now, Florida right now is in a sort of a lighter color, 238 per million. Obviously, there's a seasonality of this. And the winter has come into the Northeast, and you can see why this is a little darker right now. You look at New Hampshire, you've heard in the news that they're having some trouble with hospital beds. They're having some issues here in New Hampshire and the Northeast. So again, I point this out to you because we are in the winter. It's purple, dark, many more cases in Connecticut, and we'll walk through why that occurs and why it's important to understand what to do right now. Now, this is another graphic. I show this here in the hospital, at the Children's Hospital. We have town halls every other week, and people want to know where are we and where are we going? And this is these are new cases. The prior one was total active cases, old and new per day. These are new cases per day. These are the people that are diagnosed today with COVID-19. And let me walk you through this again. On the bottom part, you see the dates, all the way from December through December 2020 through March 2022. The brown dots is the projection. These are projected cases. And then on the left, you see daily count in the thousands. So we go back all the way back to, this doesn't start in April, this starts in December, so a little bit later in the pandemic. So last winter, we had about 5,000 cases, new cases per day in Connecticut. We didn't have vaccines. Many of these folks were ending up in the hospital. Many died, unfortunately. Vaccines came in and we saw a dramatic drop in cases, but still never quite gone away. We had a little surge here in the spring as well, more vaccination, more people, of course, then the warmer weather comes in, and there was this very significant drop in cases. We were down to about 100 per day new cases, really good news. But Delta came in, this virus that spreads more rapidly, and you saw another hump here in Delta. Now, there were more vaccinations coming in through here. Connecticut was doing a good job to trying to catch up with this virus, and that's where you see a drop here around Halloween. We were in really good shape. We're getting to be in good shape, but the winter comes in. People are less masked, a little more gatherings. We have Thanksgiving, now we have Christmas coming in. So today we're about 2,000 cases, new cases per day, about 2,000 new cases per day in Connecticut. We'll see an increase to close to 2,500 cases per day, and then we'll begin to drop off again. Now, all of this is contingent on vaccinations and getting diagnosed and doing what you need to do. Now, I'm going to show you a graphic here in green, this little dotted line in green. Why is that lower than the one up here? That's because if we were all using masks right now, if we were be more careful, I think we've lowered our guard too fast, then you can actually curve this and actually get off the roller coaster a lot more quickly than if we don't do anything about that. So again, vaccines, masking, social distancing is something that will get us quickly, more quickly, out of this rise in cases. So I just want to emphasize that. Okay, now these are the number of confirmed and probable cases. In this case, the confirmed is light blue, probable, dark blue, the probable is light blue. These are the actual tests. What I showed you before were the estimated cases. These are actual tests, but it does show the same pattern. April, we weren't testing a lot. You know, this was much higher in the prior graph because we, back in April of 2020, we just didn't have the means to test. We were just beginning. We did better last year with testing, so we diagnosed many more. We had a testing in April, lower in the summer, and then it went up with Delta. And now we're doing a lot of testing, and you can see the increase that is corresponding to the outbreak right now. All right, we go to the next slide. Now, what is different this year compared to last year and compared to the springtime? You can see these are the number of COVID-19 associated deaths by date of death. And back in April, we lost a lot of people. We lost a lot of our elderly in nursing homes. It was terrible. I think you all remember this. Very scary. Unfortunately, many of our frail individuals and people that we knew passed away from COVID-19. We didn't have enough testing. We didn't have vaccines. We didn't know exactly what to do with this. And this is what happened in the Northeast. In Connecticut, had a lot of people dying, about 100 a day, a lot. Then we got better over the summer. That came last year. Last year was still not good because we didn't have vaccines yet. And you can see how the number of deaths were still not as high as 100, but there were at least half of that. Our hospitals were full. It was also a very difficult Christmas, New Year's with a lot of COVID. Again, vaccines came in. I remember a year ago today, I got my vaccine here at Connecticut Children's. I was the first one to get it here. It was the happiest days of my life when I was able to finally get a vaccine against this virus. And you could see that it dropped. We had an increase. But again, the number of deaths was still too high back here. Now, what's new now? The virus is surging, but notice here, the deaths are lower. So we have changed the dynamic of this pandemic. It used to be cases equal deaths with vaccination, with masking, with the things that we know how to do now with prevention strategies like antibodies. What we have been able to do is now change the dynamic of not maybe all the infections, but change the dynamic of people dying. Now, unfortunately, there are still too many. One person is too many. And most of the people who are dying right now are people who are not vaccinated. People that are vaccinated and taking care of themselves, they could still get COVID possibly, but they're not dying. And that's a message that I want to give to all of you. Now we have 716 patients hospitalized right now in Connecticut. All right, let me go to the next slide. Now these are the total number of cases per age group in Connecticut. And I want to point out, and you're parents, and you want to, people ask me, does this really affect children? Well, it does. I mean, in Connecticut, we have diagnosed 31,000 children under the age of 9, 50,000 kids under the age of 19. The peak here is for the 20 to 29 year olds, and you can see how it begins to drop then for the Connecticut. But I want to highlight that they're close to 80,000 kids and 30,000 under the age of 10 who have gotten COVID-19. And this is important as you make decisions about vaccination. Now, good news for us in Connecticut is that for the pediatric group is that, fortunately, due to the proper care that we provide, the number of kids who have died are very few. One in the under the age of 10, 4, 10 to 19, 19, 20 to 29. We did, unfortunately, in Connecticut, lose a lot of our elderly over the age of 80. Almost 5,000 of our Connecticut citizens, the most frail, actually died of COVID. Now, some good news, this is the percentage of the population in Connecticut has been vaccinated. Connecticut has done a great job, and that's changing that mortality, the number of people who die. I think I mentioned that already a couple of times. And you can see here, the population that are vaccinated, 86.6%. This is fully vaccinated, so they've got two doses. Great job, 65 to 74-year-olds, 92%, even 55 to 64, 87.5. Now, unfortunately, it drops for 12 to 15 year olds is 66%, and 16 to 24, 66%. And we're just beginning, still too low, 11.5% fully vaccinated in the 5 to 11. Obviously, this is beginning to catch up. We just started this vaccination a month ago. So we still, you know, many kids have not gotten the second dose. And so this is still too low, which tells you that this population and the kids that are not eligible for vaccine are still obviously at risk of getting COVID-19. And that has a lot to do with the school systems. All right, a few slides about Omicron, then I'll finish up. You've heard about Omicron. It's the new variant. This is the 15th letter of the Greek alphabet. These variants are named, they're given Greek letter names. It started with the original strain, then the second one was Alpha. You know, we have Beta, and then all the way through, Omicron is number 15. They skipped 13 and 14. 13th letter of the Greek alphabet is new, and they didn't want to call it the new virus. It was complicated. And the 14th is Z, which is also the name of the Chinese prime minister. And so they decided not to use that one either. That's the reason they didn't. And now what you can see here through surveillance, this is when they take these viruses and do something called genetic sequencing, they can find out if the virus is Omicron or not. It only started 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago at the most. And you can see now that for the Northeast, which is region two here, it's already 13.1%. So this virus is spreading very quickly. It comprises 13% of all cases in the Northeast. Again, this is another way of showing it here for the week of 12, 11, 21 here in purple. It's 13%. Now, the region two, the sequencing for region two is New Jersey, New York, Puerto Rico, and the Virgin Islands. So it's not specific to Connecticut. But I do have some specific Connecticut numbers. This is brand new, fresh information that came out today. For Connecticut, when they do the actual sequencing, and not everything is sequenced, Delta, which is the predominant one, 13,000 cases. Omicron, which is this new one, we're already up to 40 cases in less than a week. And you can see the other ones. Alpha is still pretty high, 3,000. Beta, Gamma, Epsilon, Iota, Kappa, Mu, and Zeta are the other variants. But the one that we're concerned about is Omicron because it really spreads very quickly, and it is here now. So what can you do? Parents are asking, what do we do about Omicron? How we can fend off? How are we going to be able to get our schools open, et cetera? Well, again, if kids are eligible over the age of 5, get vaccinated. That's really the most important thing you can do. If you're vaccinated, if you're a teacher or a parent, you're already vaccinated, there's now really good evidence that if you get a booster, if you've gotten 2 doses of Moderna, 2 doses of Pfizer, get the next one. Get your third shot if you're over the age of 16 and get boosted. You get boosted, you're going to prevent infection with Omicron. That is on its way right now, and it is coming. Use masks. If you're going into public places now, this is really important. This is really important now. The schools, as they open back up in January after the holidays, the masks are going to be very critical if you don't want to have outbreaks in the schools. Obviously, you want to avoid crowded places during the holidays. If you can, gather outdoors when possible. Socially distance. Testing is very important to try to isolate. And then isolate from others if you tested positive. So be real. Don't hide that information that you're not feeling well, because you're putting somebody else at risk. So get tested if you're not feeling well. Even if you're vaccinated, you have to get tested. Okay, and I think that was my last slide. I'm going to stop sharing here. So again, I want to thank you for your attention. I'm happy to answer questions at the end. I think we're going to move on to the other panelists, and I'll hang out here for the questions. So thank you, Ingrid, and back to you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Salazar. As always, the information that you provide is just so insightful. I learned so much today regarding the history of this virus and what it's doing, not only in Connecticut, but in the nation and worldwide. So thank you so much. So at this time, before we move to our next expert, our Commissioner of Education, Charlene Russell Tucker, is able to join us today. I'm so glad that you're here, Commissioner, and I know that you would like to say a couple of words to all those attending this session, the webinar today. Commissioner?
Thank you very much, Ingrid, and my thanks to CIRC as always for your great facilitation. And for the crew is back together is what I feel like saying. So Dr. Salazar, Dr. Ketter, and Dr. Dudley, thank you so much for taking the time to join all those in our audience today. staying in school safely during COVID-19, and even with you all for parents and families. And so thank you for us sharing your expertise with us. And for those in the audience, thank you again for coming together to learn more. As Ingrid said, it's an education for us to learn it. It then allows us to make the decisions that we need to make. And everything that we do here is in service of making sure that our school communities can be as safe as they are. So our students being able to learn in person, our educators being able to be there safely, and for things to go forward, as we know how critical in-person learning is. And so as we go through this time of the year, right, we have a few other things to be thinking about. So this is so timely to make sure that you can get direct information directly from the source. There's lots of information that float out around us. So you can count on the fact that these are experts or doctors here are giving you credible information that you can take and that you can share. Finally, thank you, John and Judy, for your continued work in making sure that we can make these available. And so I talk about this a lot when I talk to folks out of state. We've got these virtual house calls and we're sharing information directly with families. And so thank you again for coming together for this. And I'll send it back to you, Ingrid, so you keep, the program must continue. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Commissioner Russell Tucker. And again, Dr. Salazar, thank you so much for that information. And as I was looking at your charts, I have to be very honest, my affective filter keep going up and down as I see what has happened through the last 2 years. So, which is gonna bring me, as I welcome our next expert to speak to us, is specifically about mental health, thinking about everything that we have gone through. So at this time, I would like to welcome Dr. Ketter, who's going to talk to us about mental health implications of living through the pandemic. And how can we, as parents, educators, family members, teachers, how can we understand and support what is happening with our students in our schools today? So Dr. Ketter, you have the floor. Thank you.
Hi, good evening, everyone. Thank you. And thank you for having me. It's always a privilege to join. And it is most definitely a privilege to work with our patients and families who are also going through all of this. This is something that we've been doing together. So what I'd like to do today is talk about how we can support our children. Some brief disclosures. I do not have any financial conflicts of interest. I use a lot of pictures here. Many are from Google or Unsplash for nonprofit purposes. Key point, this provides general suggestions and not specific medical advice, as many children have very different or nuanced and specific needs. And I'm also a board member for the Connecticut Family Support Network. So quickly, some basics to give us some groundwork together. We know that when kids grow and learn, they do because they have experiences, educational experiences, they interact with people. That literally builds the brain. Those interactions, though, aren't just one way. It's a back and forth interaction. And this is where serve and return interaction really shapes how the brain learns and grows. But there's one final point that's really important. We know that a lot of stress can kind of throw off healthy development. And that's something we call toxic stress. It's not something we want kids to have to deal with, but it is part of the reality that we live through. Now, you're asking, what is toxic stress? Well, there's regular positive stress, what your body experiences when you might get a vaccine or have your first day of school or go to meet someone for the first time. There's tolerable stress, which is more severe, but still limited. And it might be due to the loss of a grandparent, breaking a bone, or not doing so well on a test that you liked. And then there's what we call toxic stress. This is strong, prolonged adversity. Things like experiencing physical or emotional abuse, witnessing violence, living in a country going through a civil war. And one of the things I'd like to suggest is that what COVID has done is it's really put all of us for the past 20 plus months in a state of experiencing toxic stress. Now, this toxic stress is biological. There's an actual way that we have learned that it works through the body. And we can process it through understanding a psychological perspective of how do we think about what we need? Well, before the pandemic, the majority of us had the privilege of having to focus on needs that were in the focused on us, our psychological and our self-fulfillment needs. We could focus on how we feel and how we want to accomplish things because a lot of our basic needs were met. But with the pandemic coming on, and COVID, we've lost the ability to take that for granted. We had to focus on, do people have food? Does everybody have housing? Do people feel safe at home? Are we still connected with loved ones? And that's a reality. Now, the good news is that we're getting there. Now, that feeling, that reality is the emptiness that we've been feeling, but there's hope that with vaccines, with public health measures like masking, social distancing, we're moving back up. And as Dr. Salazar showed the data, it looks better. And we're starting to see that that's helping kids move back into that resilient, thriving place that we want. But when COVID started, we had to think critically. We had to make sure kids were getting food for school. We had to make sure that kids were feeling safe at home because there was a lot of stress going on. We also needed to think about what was going on. Some kids lost family members and parents, so they're experiencing grief. Many kids had changes to daily routines and habits. So we're seeing lots of kids with sleep problems, eating problems, emotional regulation problems, and a lot more screen time, for better or for worse. Now, there's also been changes in support and treatments, access to things like therapies, medication, childcare, adult supports. And then all of us have had to deal with new situations and learn new behaviors. How do we learn how to access in-person learning? How do we learn how to use face masks? And how do we help all of our kids do the same? There was a great paper that came out in the Journal of Pediatrics, which is one of our core journals, this summer, and it looked at what were the behavioral health issues that families have been experiencing. And what we found was there were major impacts on the family structure and for kids. For families, we saw an increase in parental mental health issues. We saw a huge increase in parental stress. We saw a lot more conflict or fighting between parents and their kids. And we saw a lot more chaos, right? That's what it's felt like for a couple of months. But with kids themselves, we're seeing a lot more externalizing behaviors, things like aggression and fighting. We're seeing a lot more internalizing behaviors, sadness and anxiety. We're seeing a lot more self-care skill problems like emotional regression. It's like, honey, I know you know how to feed yourself. I'm not gonna feed you, right? But feed me, mommy, please, right? These are coping skills that kids are trying to use. And more importantly, we're seeing a lot of dysregulated behaviors. These are the meltdowns. These are why kids are going from 0 to 100. I'm surprised this is why we're going from 0 to 100, because this is really hard. Something else to really acknowledge that's been important, as Dr. Salazar mentioned, there have been a lot of deaths in the country. This paper that came out in Pediatrics this fall highlights the fact that over the course of a 15-month period, 140 children in the United States lost a key parent or grandparent who was their caregiver. I've not thought of the term orphan or orphanhood outside of reading books, but this is a reality. 140,000 children in the country lost someone very important. And the reality is too, when we look at that data, it's not the same for everyone. If we look at every 100,000 children who lost, for every 100,000 children, one child who identifies as not Hispanic white lost a parent or caregiver. But if you identify as Latinx, almost twice as likely to have lost a parent. If you identify as BIPOC or Black, almost 2.5 times as likely. And if you identify as Native American, almost 5 times as likely to have lost a parent or caregiver. So part of this is the real reality that still at the core and base of all of this syndemic or multiple pandemics happening together are social determinants of health. And we know that the experience of COVID, trauma, grief, and systemic issues like racism all intersect to have an effect on parent-child mental health. Childcare with all of this affects parent and child mental health. Housing affects parent and child mental health. Food security, income and job security, all affects parent and child mental health. So we're walking into 2022. What are we still experiencing? Well, we've got burnout and fatigue. We're still dealing with normal stressors, right? Holidays, school vacation, dealing with the fact that sundown happens at 5:30. We've got trickle down from global level problems and gridlock. So like supply chain issues, economy issues. There's a lot of information and a lot of misinformation. Navigating that is a stressful reality. And also important is learning how to manage our biologic, what I call mama bear or papa bear response, which is our emotional to protect our kids. So here are some strategies and here's what we can do to help. Our goal is we want kids to be resilient. So how do we help them develop the ability to deal with adversity and come out strong? Well, we know from science, these are 4 key things we can do. Build supportive and nurturing adult-child relationships. Build a sense of self-efficacy or I can do it and perceived control. We can provide opportunities or chances to help kids build adaptive skills like being flexible and self-regulation skills like emotional control. And we can actually mobilize sources of faith, hope, and cultural traditions because we know that that's protective for kids and for us. Okay, what are things that we need to think about? Well, some kids are a little bit more vulnerable. Think about your child. Are they easygoing? Some kids are pretty easygoing straight from birth. But we can tell even as babies, some kids are a little bit more spirited or fussy, and some are really sensitive or shy. Not all kids deal with the same level of stress differently. And what it really boils down to is some kids are at less risk for dealing with this level of stress and some are at more risk. So ask yourself, is your child a dandelion? Are they able to just push up through adversity in the sidewalk? Or are they an orchid? Are they a child who's beautiful, has so much skills and capacity, but needs the right temperature, humidity, soil acidity, and nutrients to have everything perfect in order to stay stable? But here's the thing, those internal factors don't compare to the most important thing, which is what helps kids be resilient is having an adult be there for them, having a parent or other family member who can provide a safe, stable, and nurturing relationship. So here are some analogies for COVID. I've used this one before. It's like we've been on a super slow motion plane crash, right? Some days we forget we're in it because it's going in such slow motion. But the reality is oxygen masks have been down for a while. And when it comes to taking care of our kids, we have to ask ourselves, have we put our oxygen mask on first, right? We can call for flight attendants, we can call for everyone else we want, but the reality is if we don't get our mask on ourselves, we're not going to be able to help our child or access the supports that we need. Here's my analogy number two, and this is where I call it the mama bear, papa bear response. We're all biologically programmed to want to protect our kids. And this is what toxic stress does, right? If there is a bear or a tiger, we go into our protective bear or tiger, right? But the question is there a bear or a tiger, right? Or has it been going on for so long that it's kind of like, you know, the dog who's barking at the letter carrier? And I say that with respect of my dad being a letter carrier, right? We could fall into the pattern of being this dog, right? So we meet again. Or we can question and challenge ourselves because sometimes our biological programming can fool us. And that's helpful to be aware of. So if you want a practical approach, let's focus on going back to that pyramid and making sure we've got a secure base with those basic needs being met. And then we can work our way back up to feeling safe and secure. Remember, your oxygen mask is part of that safety plan. But if we want a realistic approach, here are three things that you can do. Ground yourself, check for bears or threats, and build resilience with your kids. Grounding yourself, right? We know that that ability for you to be there for your child is the single most critical thing, which basically means we need you, they need you. So in order to be here, we want you to help take care of yourself, ground yourself. Ask, are you sleeping? Have you eaten? Have you gone for a walk? Do you feel grounded? Double check. Do you have your own oxygen mask on? Are you in your green zone? Because if we're not at our emotional neutral place, we can't help anchor our children to get back to that emotional neutral place. So please, please take care of yourselves. Once we do that, we can check for bears or threats, right? And we can respond accordingly. Ask, where's your inner protective mama bear, papa bear? Is an alarm going off? Is there really a threat? Or is it the illusion or feeling of a threat? But when we check, there is no tiger, there is no wolf. Then we can ask, okay, how's our kid doing? Are they sleeping? Are they eating? Are they safe? Who's helping watch them? Who's our backup plan in case we need to help? And then check in, what's the emotional pulse? Where's your child? Where are they feeling? Are they feeling connected? Are they feeling disconnected? Are they vulnerable or not vulnerable? And then unplug, find any threats. Sometimes too much news is too much, unplug. Sometimes just being connected and grounded together as a family for a day is helpful. And ultimately, check in with your team. You have two sets of people who are wonderful. You have your healthcare providers, like your child's pediatrician or primary care provider. You also have your teachers and other support staff at school who are there for your child. Know your child. Are they that easygoing kid who's adventurous? Or are they a little fussy or sensitive, right? Because if they are, we want to pay more attention to these kids. And if we're going to build resilience, we can do this through a couple of things. We can keep supportive relationships. Check in with family, check in with grandparents, check in with people who are living across the country. We can be socially distant, but not isolated. Build those coping skills, use schedules, train flexibility. Flexibility is not something that's innate, it's a learned skill. And role model kindness and compassion. We want our kids to emulate what we're doing. So pass that kindness on. And if you do need more support, this is where we can build teams. Get a counselor, and there are counselors available through school or through your health insurance. Talk with both your school and healthcare providers, because that's where we can help build your team to take care of your child. Right? We can still support those nurturing relationships by planning visits with family and friends in safe, socially distanced ways. We can build a sense of how kids can do it by helping kids relearn things that they knew how to do before life hit the hard zone or red zone. We can show them how we're coping. We can be transparent, but we want to teach skills. And most importantly, we still want to celebrate and do the things that help us anchor and connect, but we want to do it safely. They're important, but we want to do it in a safe way. So there are lots of things you can do for self-care. Thank you, people like Sean Mendes, for trying to break out and reach out to teens, right? How can we call and take care of ourselves? But remember, mental and emotional health doesn't start as an adolescent, it starts as a toddler. How are we helping our sensitive child learn how to cope with hard things? How are we learning how to cope with not getting what we want immediately? This was an article early in the pandemic that came from the Dalai Lama. And, you know, he really said, we need compassion, right? And if we accept the fact that no one signed up for this, but we're all in it together, it will help ground us together. It will help us give everyone space, because we're remembering everyone's figuring this out too. And everyone else is tired too. We want to be patient, because everybody's not just working at 110%, they're working at 120%. And just as much as our healthcare providers have been the front line, so have our teachers and school staff workers, and so have you for helping facilitate this for your children. Give your kids some wiggle room. They're pulling in all of this, and they don't necessarily have the ability to express themselves or let it out in the same way. So we want to be patient and respect that everyone's still figuring it out. So if we all adapt through this together, we'll do it. Respect and give yourself space. You are important. You deserve to take care of yourself. So please, please focus on that self-care. And then finally, role model kindness and compassion. It could be $5 of a snack that you purchase for a coworker. It could be 5 minutes of time you give your spouse or a child when you're busy and distracted, but they just need that 5 minutes of your time. Or it could be a 5-pound lift, somebody who asks you to carry a grocery or something to a car, right? Those little things add up and they help. I know that this is what you're feeling, so this is why we want to partner, right? Life at home feels chaotic, but on the other side of the fence, things can feel chaotic in schools, but together, we're working through all of this. So here's your last set of toolkits. If you have a camera or you're watching on your phone, screenshot and take pictures really quick. Lots of resources for your back pocket. We have our COVID hotline. There's advice for parents on our blog for the Children's Hospital. 211 or United Way helps connect families with all different kinds of services. If you're struggling with trying to figure out electronics and navigating all of that, commonsensemedia.org is a wonderful website. If you want to learn more about special education and COVID, understood.org is a great website. Connecticut Family Support Network is very helpful for families. And then finally, most importantly, the Connecticut State Department of Education website has amazing resources for how to navigate all of this. If you have a child who's experienced the loss of someone and you need some extra support, this is a really great handout for how to deal and cope with traumatic grief. And it's something there that you can utilize. And here are some apps, books, and programs that are really great. There's the Sesame Place Breathe, Think, Do app. There's the Calm app, shows like Daniel Tiger, books like The Color Monster, tools like the Zones of Regulation, or even anger management cards are all wonderful tools to have in your kit to help your kids. And finally, in case you need something, we have a warm line in the state of Connecticut. If you're having a hard time and just want to talk with someone, the Connecticut Behavioral Health Partnership has a warm line with prompts and people available in multiple languages. So call, don't be afraid. You owe that to yourself. Finally, if you want a big picture strategy, this is where it's really important to think, how do we help kids through all of this? Kids can't vote, so I will always talk with my trainees. We want to be the voice of kids. So if you want to get up to date on different policy things, feel free to sign up for our policy blog and updates, but vote, kids need us there. So that wraps me up. If you need to do stuff for yourself, I like music. If you haven't heard it, I don't like holiday music, but there is this album by Sting and Shaggy. It's amazing. If you need some good tunes, John Batiste has a great album. And if you want to connect with your teenagers, Coldplay and BTS came out with a duet together. It's really good. So thank you so much. And we'll hang out for questions.
Dr. Peters, thank you so much. There is so much information that you always provide to all of us. I just, every time, I'm always taking notes when all of you are in the space. So thank you so much. I am being incredibly conscious of the time. We never have enough time to hear all of you and your expertise. So at this time, I'm going to welcome Dr. Dudley, who's going to help us to really continue to build community between school and families in the midst of the challenges that we are facing as a community. So Dr. Dudley, you have the floor.
Thank you. And I'm going to try and find my PowerPoint here to share. Got too much open. There we go. So first of all, just thank you, everyone. For attending, and I really want to thank Ingrid for just wonderful facilitating and the commissioner for the opportunity to speak to everyone. My name's Rob Dudley. I'm a general pediatrician at the Community Health Center of New Britain and a school medical advisor and the immediate past president of the Connecticut chapter of the American Academy of Pediatrics. And for all pediatricians across the state, just really want to say it's an honor to partner with you parents and also with school staff in trying to help us sort of navigate this crazy thing that is COVID. So I want to start off by acknowledging some things that Dr. Cater and Dr. Salazar noted, and that is that we are all stressed. I think everyone is at a breaking point. We thought we were at breaking points previously, and then things looked rosy during the summer, and then variants started, and things that we took for granted are no longer things we can take for granted. Anxiety and depression, as we noted the last time we were here in August, are really on the rise, both in parents and in children, and how we deal with them will sort of determine how we get through the rest of the school year and the future. And as I said, nothing seems certain. We really can't take anything for granted, and things that we thought we knew yesterday, really we don't seem to know today. But there are some real positives out there. We know a lot more about the virus. Dr. Salazar presented some really amazing data on the fact that even though cases are going up through the things that we have done as a community and as individuals, we're able to turn that curve so that the death rate is coming down. So there looks like there's hope. We have really effective prevention strategies. I'm gonna say them again, but I know Dr. Kidder and Dr. Salazar both mentioned a lot of things that we can do as individuals to help protect ourselves and our families. And most importantly, we have vaccines. Truly the miracle of this pandemic has been that we've been able to develop vaccines in record time. They've been distributed widely and they're widely available and they work. We can see every day. I want to throw a little bit of a personal story out there. My mother, who's immunocompromised, had to move in with my sister this fall after she took a fall and broke her arm. My niece at a school screening up in New Hampshire tested positive a couple weeks ago. My sister and brother developed symptoms and both got COVID, and my mother, who had gotten her booster shot, has not. She's quarantining safely back in her apartment, and she's just past 10 days now, so she's safe. So I just really want to encourage folks that are out there to take advantage of the opportunities both to get your children vaccinated and if you've had the vaccine to get boosted. And finally, we do have treatments. That monoclonal antibody that Dr. Salazar talked about, the coping strategies that Dr. Cater talked about are all things that we can do to both physically and mentally cope with this pandemic and move forward. So I'll echo Dr. Cater again, take care of yourself, take a break. If you need to, take a deep breath. Know your sources of information. So we've all been sharing multiple websites and places that folks can go to learn more. It's important to check your sources. I will point out one little error on the Department of Education. As I was going through everything, the AAA plan, which was updated back in August, talks about folks 12 and over getting the vaccine. And we know now that it's 5 to 12. So if you look at a piece of information or you're confused by something that doesn't seem to match, one thing I always encourage people to do is look at the last modified date that's on the bottom of most good sources of information. That AAA plan was last redone when school was starting in August. So obviously things have changed since then. CDC's website, which is pretty much continuously updated, is the one I sort of go to for my latest and greatest. And then the AAP website that I'm going to share at the end of this also does a great job of updating things. Although I will say, you know, even things like sports guidance was updated at the beginning of September. Before that, it was previously earlier in the spring, and the data that was there up until that time when they updated, some of it had gotten stale. So always check those dates and know what you're looking at and that it's a reliable source. And I think the other thing we've heard tonight is that it's very, very important to think about change and accept that things that are going to change, things that we've taken for granted may not always turn out when we look at them through an eye of data and medicine and science may not always hold up, and some things certainly do. Different places have different rules. So we've seen that before, especially as some of the mask mandates have changed. Things that you do inside are different than the things that you do outside. Things that you do in schools where not all children, or preschools or daycare centers where not all children are immunized or can be immunized, may be different than things that we do in other settings. And finally, I just want to double say what Dr. Kater said, kindness matters, right? As we get stressed, confused, and upset, it's important to take a breath and remember, you know, that other folks are also stressed, and that taking the time to sort of think your words through or wait before you press that send button or start to get upset, it's time to take a break and think about things and maybe rephrase. So a quick review. In talking to school nurses and prepping for this, just remember COVID-19 symptoms, I think folks sometimes get confused. It's not all of the above, it's really any of the above. So fever or chills, cough, shortness of breath or trouble breathing, fatigue, muscle or body aches, headache, new loss of taste or smell, a sore throat, congestion or runny nose, nausea or vomiting or diarrhea. So unfortunately, at this time of year, that pretty much covers just about any symptom you're going to have. I frequently am talking to families in telehealth, and they have a lot of these symptoms. Unfortunately, many of the viruses that children pre-COVID got, adenoviruses, enteroviruses, other coronaviruses, cause many of the same symptoms. And the only way that we really know what's happening is to do follow-up and testing. But please don't send your kids to school if they have these symptoms. And that aforementioned sister was coughing for 3 or 4 days and wondering if she should get tested before she finally, or my niece, turned positive. It's important when you get that cough the second day or so, like don't send them to school, and do get folks tested. Remember, there are two types of tests, viral and antibody, and we're using both types of the viral tests now. The PCR molecular test is the one that's more sensitive. It's also the one that takes a little bit longer. So when you do the swab, it can take 2 or 3 days to get the results back. Those are coming back faster than they used to. The antigen tests are the rapid tests, and people may get those right before going to, say, a surgical procedure or before going to an event where they want to check. They're also available in a lot of pharmacies and probably will become more available over the next year. They're the sort of tests that I'd recommend that you do a day or two before you go for that Christmas gathering. And again, maybe the day of the Christmas gathering. They're much more effective if you're really trying to screen, if you do one a couple days before and one the day of at getting a better sensitivity. They still aren't quite as good as the PCR test, though. For most folks looking to get back into school, they're gonna ask you to do a PCR test. The PCR test is also, if someone's getting screened who's asymptomatic, a much more sensitive test. So for treatment, remember, COVID is sort of like a cold, especially for most folks, a super cold or the flu. It's important to stay home and take care of yourself. Get lots of rest and stay hydrated. There's good over-the-counter medicines you can take for symptom relief. And as a good pediatrician, I'll always say don't try and stay away from the multi-symptom cold relief just because there's a lot of stuff in there you may not need, but a medicine to treat each of your major symptoms. So Tylenol for fevers and aches and pains, cough medicine, glifenicin, or plain Robitussin for cough. There's a lot of things you can do just in terms of having a humidifier, and for little kids, nasal syringes to suck out mucus can all help. Stay in touch with your doctor if you're starting to have worsening symptoms, especially. You don't want to go out in public, or especially go on in public transportation or ride sharing services or taxis. I think one of the good things to come out of COVID has been the widespread availability of telehealth. So many of your primary care providers are able to see you in a video visit on Zoom, and it's a very nice way to be able to interact and offer advice. And then finally, keep yourself, don't send your kid to school, try and minimize your interactions with others. So there are some things to worry about, but that unfortunate mortality rate is not zero. If folks start having trouble breathing, especially worse symptoms that seem out of proportion to a regular cold, persistent chain or pressure in your chest, new onset confusion, inability to stay awake or to stay up, or signs of problems with your oxygenation like bluish lips or facial cyanosis, we call it, those are all warning signs that say you really should seek emergency care. Once again, most primary care providers have advice lines in round-the-clock coverage. Dial their office or know what their access is or what your access is to your PCP before you need it, and keep those numbers handy on your cell phone so you're able to access them. If you have been exposed, there are new rules sort of for those who've been vaccinated. Generally, people do not have to quarantine after contact if they've had an exposure, unless they have symptoms. Fully vaccinated folks should get tested about 5 to 7 days after the exposure, just to double check. And they should be sure to practice good mitigation practices like social distancing and wearing masks, especially indoors. And then it's really important to talk to your school system, because as we've sort of moved beyond the initial emergency orders, many school districts have slight variations in how they implement these guidelines and recommendations. Your school's school nurse is certainly able to, but once again, remember, there are differences and they're not all the same. So if you have kids that go to a magnet school, the rules might be slightly different from the ones who are going to the public school and district. Finally, I'd just like to share some resources. These are my favorite sort of go-to places. They're all sort of public websites, and I'll show you pictures of the face pages, but the CDC is sort of our go-to for all things COVID. They have a great webpage that has great advice on anything you could really want, both as a parent for students and also for caregivers and for primary care providers and specialists. The American Academy of Pediatrics Healthy Children website has just a wealth of information for parents. Many of the things Dr. Cater was talking about in terms of resilience, building resilience, and activities you can do with your kids can also be found there. They also have pages in multiple languages. The Connecticut Department of Education's portal also will keep you up to date. I'm just going to show some pictures of those now. So this is the CDC's landing page. You can see that there's different places for different folks and different questions. This is the State Department of Education webpage. And finally, the American Academy of Pediatrics homepage. And I want to just thank you all for taking the time to join us tonight. And I'm going to turn it back over to Ingrid.
Dr. Dudley, thank you so much. It's just so reaffirming, confirming all the things that we need to keep in mind as we try to support our students, our children, our sons, our daughters, our family members. So thank you to all of you. Dr. Salazar, thank you so much, Dr. Ketter and Dr. Dudley, for this wealth of information. I'm going to do something that I never do as a facilitator, because I know how precious your time is. I always want to keep within the time. We say 5 to 6. So I am humbly going to ask you if you will be willing to stay an extra 10 minutes. And the reason that I'm asking you to do that is because what you have provided is so insightful on many different levels. And I know that there's a couple of questions that have come through, and I would like to see if it's possible. So with your permission, I will ask you if it's okay to ask you for an extra 10 minutes of your time.
Sure.
And for our participants today, my apologies for those of you in the space. If you have seen my facilitation, I'm a stickler for time. So if you want to stay to hear some of the responses, please feel free. And you have to leave, we definitely understand. But at this time, I think we have a couple of the hands raised that I would like to bring into the space if they still in the space. And I'm going to ask my colleague, Greg Glidden, if he can actually name those individuals and we can have them ask the question directly to our experts. Greg? Okay, I think I have.
Yes, thank you. The first person is Catherine Dalton, has had her hand raised for a while. Catherine, you can unmute yourself and ask your question now if you'd like.
Hi, thank you so much. I appreciate that. I wanted to know if there's any update about the boosters for 14-year-olds. And then I know it's going to be a hot topic, but I'm going to go ahead and why do we not have a mask mandate in Connecticut?
Catherine, thank you so much for your question and your patience. So I'm going to see which one of our experts would like to answer that question.
The first one was about the boosters. And
yes.
So Catherine, thank you for that question. And obviously, we all want to get things done more quickly. And we would want to have these vaccines available with this full formulation across the board. I think part of the reason is that obviously the company, in this case Pfizer, which is the one that's doing most of these studies, although Moderna is coming that way with that as well, they want to make sure that it is indicated that you know, for the 12 to 16 year olds, 12 to 15 year olds, that in fact do they really need that booster at that age? Are there any potential side effects for it? So they just have to be careful. I think this is part of the reassurance to the public that, these companies or the FDA, they don't rush into decision-making. And they have been extra careful with the kids, rightfully so, in my opinion. So hopefully soon we'll hear about it. We have the 16-year-olds now that can get Pfizer, but we're not quite there for the 14-year-olds. In terms of the mask mandate, those are the decisions that are made by the governor. What I would say to you and to everyone is that what I do personally now when I go into a public place is I wear my mask. Mm-hmm. I'm fully aware of the number of kids and adults that are getting COVID-19 now, because I see the numbers, I hear the phone calls. And so we are in a surge right now. So it makes sense to me that for your family members, for yourself, go ahead and wear the mask. That's really important.
Yep, I absolutely agree. I'd just like to see more people doing it. Thank you very much.
Catherine, thank you so much for your question and for your patience. Thank you. Greg, that we have, I'm going to actually take two more questions if that's possible, because I want to honor the time that I requested of the experts. Greg?
The next raised hand is Mike Poirier. Mike, you can unmute yourself.
Hello, thank you for taking my question. I am actually asking in the same vein of the masking. I have a 3-year-old and she does have to wear her mask in classrooms, but I've noticed on the World Health Organization's recommendations, they do not recommend masks for children under 5. Is there any reason why we don't follow their recommendation?
Thank you so much for your question. See which one of the doctors would like to answer that question.
Rob, this is probably a good one for you.
Thank you. I can't speak to the resource allocation component of this, because that might be something that's also driving it. But in a resource-rich environment like we have here in Connecticut, where we do have access to masks and masking, most kids actually can wear masks. I work with children with many developmental disabilities, and many have learned to wear masks, and it's not a problem. In the same way, we train children to learn how to wear pants or wear diapers. It is a behavior that's learned. We know that it's helpful, and we know that there is actual harm reduction by wearing the mask. So for right now, that's where we're basing our guidelines off of. but this is always a moving target, and we are trying to do best practice for children. And I, as a physician, say our first goal is always do no harm. But in this case, this is a global pandemic. We still have numbers that are up, and we do need to use our public health and safety measures. If a building's on fire, we can't go in unless we have the appropriate equipment. And in this case, we're still in a pandemic, so we still need to utilize the appropriate equipment.
Thank you so much for your response, Mike. Thank you so much for your question. Greg, one more.
And the final question will be from David Cohen. David, you can unmute yourself.
Great, thank you very much. I actually am a director of a nursery school and a religious school, and coming up with policies and supporting parents, of course, is a big challenge. So I don't know if Dr. Dudley, this sounds like it might be up your alley, but when there is an exposure, when someone who is unvaccinated and gets exposed to someone who is positive, what is the current best thinking and how long that person should quarantine and or test?
David, thank you for your question. Dr. Dudley.
So you know, the current sort of standard in most places is at least 10 days, up to 2 weeks. And I think we've sort of backed off a little bit. Initially, it was everywhere was sort of 2 weeks. And now most places are saying 10 days. There certainly are some opportunities depending sort of on the type of exposure and the conditions to do some testing after 5 to 7 days. And with a negative test, perhaps even get out as soon as that result is negative, or at least after 7 days. So it's a constantly evolving field. And I think as you're looking as a preschool director to put together the best policies, looking at that CDC website is definitely the place where you want to go. The State Department of Education also has some great resources for folks, and some of the addenda to the AAA policy all contain sort of great suggested pathways depending on how the exposure occurred, what the length of exposure was. But the hard thing about this pandemic is as we get more sensitive and more fine-tuned and can make perhaps shorter quarantine periods for some folks, that means that there's a lot more complexity to it than just saying, just do X, Y, or Z. And that's a part of the stress that I think people feel and some of the confusion that folks feel. But I really would recommend that CDC website. And if you go under for in the school section, they've got great recommendations.
Thank you so much, Dr. Dudley. Thank you again to our expert panelists for all your insight today. And from my perspective, it's been a pleasure just hearing you and providing this level of information to all of our participants. And to all of our participants, thank you so much for joining us today. We are going to be recording this session, and it's going to be available in the State Department of Education website. It's going to be translated in multiple languages. So we do ask to give us a little bit of time so that we can go through the process to translate, but make sure that you share this information with other ones so that they can actually have access to what it was provided today. So with that said, from my perspective as a facilitator, I'm going to pass it over either to our Commissioner of Education, Charlene Russell Tucker, so it's going to close us. And thank you again for all that you're doing and for your service. Thank you so much, Commissioner.
Thank you very much. And we're not going to break up this band. So at some point, we'll be back so our participants can look out for that. But again, thank you so much for the partnership with all of you and your organizations, Connecticut Children's and the American Academy of Pediatrics, and all the work with our school medical advisors. That really is what it's going to take for all of us to support all of our families, all of our educators, and our entire community, and to keep Connecticut in general, as safe as we can, so we can get back to whatever, I don't know what we're calling it these days. Is there a new normal? But to get back there for all of us. So that's great. Thanks again to our staff. Ingrid, thank you for, as always, your great facilitation. And, the information about the social emotional well-being, mental health, so critical for all of us. And so thank you for putting that in the space. And so we'll continue to provide resources. David, if you're still on, Our website has a nice scenarios document. It's addendum 5 as to what to do in schools. And I know the Office of Early Childhood has a companion document there as well. So if you can't find it on CDC, you should be able to find it on one of our state websites to assist you. Thank you all for the extra time that you've spent this evening, and be safe, be well, until next time.
Thank you so much. Happy holidays as well.
Thank you.